Ready to begin? Okay, folks, we'll call the meeting to order. This is the November meeting of the Huntington Woods Planning Commission. The first order of business is to call the order, which I've just done. Next is roll call. We'll start on my far left with Eric.
Eric Slutsky.
Aaron Sullivan.
David Schwartz.
Martha Schrod.
Andy Dockrow.
Jill Clamper.
Sheldon Cohen.
The next item on the agenda is to approve the agenda, which is before us. Do I have a motion to approve it? Although I do notice that there is no space for other business, and there may be a discussion tonight of other business. With that observation, does anyone want to make a motion for the agenda?
I move to approve the agenda with the addition of other discussion as a topic.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Agenda is approved unanimously. The next item of business is to approve the minutes from the last meeting.
Two meetings.
The last two meetings. And we'll take the first set of minutes from October 5th. Does anyone have any comments or would like to make a motion?
Move to approve.
The October 5th set?
October 5th.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion?
That's good.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? None. The minutes from October 5 are unanimously approved. And the next item is from October 24. If anyone would like to have any comments or make a motion.
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor of the motion to approve the October 24 minutes as is, say aye.
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 All those opposed? The minutes from October 24 are also unanimously approved. The next item on the agenda for our consideration is the matter of review of an attached garage addition to the Gosh residence at 8911 Lincoln. You're up, and we look forward to hearing from you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Shomit Ghosh. We are proposing, my wife and I are proposing to add a garage to 8911 Lincoln, the old Fishman house that we closed on in September. We're proposing, based on the layout, as you can see in the site plan that you have here, to put a garage. When you look at the house to the right of the house, there is one existing garage that has a size of 440 square foot. We're proposing a garage that has 320 additional square foot. We understand that we go slightly over what the maximum allowed is, so we come with a request for a small variance. We have scheduled to be on the Zoning Board of Appeals for mid-December to discuss this variance. The garage itself, if you look at the plans,
I've got it. I have a screen version. If
yeah, why don't we go through the presentation and then we'll hear the Mr. Garr's presentation,
fine,
if I'm pronouncing that correctly, and then you'll give yours.
Yeah. So can I just quickly finish?
Yeah. Why don't you finish your presentation?
So when you look at the plans and when you look at the garage, what it's proposed is that it's it looks architecturally like the rest of the house. We will match the existing brick on the front, on the side, and in the back. We have drawn up windows on all sides, so that it follows that requirement. The layout of the garage with the roof fits the architectural original design of the house. We have also made sure that we consider the correct side setback, and that we're within that limit. And with the conditional approval through the ZBA, the ask for approval on the additional garage.
Thank you. Anything else?
I think that's it.
Okay, great.
Andy, no, unfortunately there is not any presentation per se. What I do have though available for the planning commission, if you would like to see, would be in fact what you are looking at on paper in front of you. So this is a larger version than of the detail that you have here. So if anyone in the audience or someone wants to.
Why don't we do that, just for the sake of
All right.
David and anyone else would like to see the big image?
Yep.
Get this light here real quick.
So, Hank, with his one bum knee, determined to prepare a couple slides for you. What a wonderful man he is. And here you have, then, you can see on the right, that addition. Now, I don't, it's kind of tough to see there. You all have seen the home. And here is the home, then, and let me get this up so it's a little bit better for you to see. And there is the house. You all know this house pretty well. There's the original garage as it sits today. And obviously, as you well know, and I don't need to reiterate, the garage will go on the right of that structure and be a flat roof. That would be the feature of the garage. There is the detail from the plan you're looking at in front of you, the additional footprint of the plan. And then this is how it looks in the front elevation. And I think Hank has been so kind as to prepare, yes, a side elevation. You can see then from, I guess that would be Wyoming then, how that would look. And then here is the rear elevation as it shows from the back of the home. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to just black out this screen, Andy, and then if anyone has any questions or wants to look at this again in this view, they can do so.
Okay, great.
Yep.
Thank you so much. We do have, just for the record, a memo from Hank that I want to make sure that we've all had a chance to review. Obviously, he pointed out something that you did, which is that no matter what is decided tonight, you'll require a variance by the ZBA. So that is not our decision to make. With that, why don't we start comments with Eric?
Thank you for the presentation. I really have no comments. I mean, we're matching existing brick. We have windows. It appears from Hank's memo that the variance is actually something due to the existing house itself, not due to anything else. I have no comments.
Well, maybe we could just make sure we're all clear as to why you need the garage, what motivated you to seek the addition.
So the current garage has a size of 440 square foot,
mm-hmm.
if you take the outside. When we put our vehicles in the garage, the existing entrance into the house is actually blocked. So we want to make sure that with an additional garage, we have the opportunity to park the vehicle in there. And then the variance comes because we're trying to catch an additional entrance door to the house to make for a safe and secure entry so that in inclement weather, we don't have to walk around the house.
Thank you. Aaron?
Sorry, I'm confused at what is driving the variance?
The size of the garage, the size of the addition.
Upper limit to garage square footage?
Yep.
Okay. And how much are we exceeding that requirement by, just out of curiosity?
By 110 square foot.
Okay. Okay. I guess I have no further question on this. Won't be taken care of by the ZBA.
Okay.
No questions or comments?
I'm a little disappointed. I appreciate that you have sought out the same brick and that you have included windows and so forth. It's just from the front view and from the side view, it looks unfinished because of the flat roof. And nowhere else in your architecture do you have a flat roof. You have a shed roof and you have a gable roof, but you don't have a flat roof. So awkward to me. And that's just an aesthetic observation. to an issue with garages over on, was that LaSalle Lane or Talbot Lane, where someone wanted to add three garages and we said no. And these garages are facing the front, which I know is existing. That other issue was on the side of the house, so I'm wondering where we set with that. Where do we stand with that?
I don't remember how we resolved it. Does anyone remember whether that was approved or not?
I thought it was approved as part of a, because it was one of those, it was one of the large homes that was built.
Yeah.
And they had a three car garage.
It was smaller when they were done.
How many garages were on the one on Borton that that we saw not that long ago, when the house was being torn down and built with the pool in there?
I don't remember.
I'm just concerned with being
not great.
It wasn't three, was it?
No.
Because that's a front facing?
I'm concerned about our consistency. So those are my observations.
You said, what is the issue with getting to the house from the garage?
So apparently when you park both cars in the garage, and given the space that is in the garage is 440 square foot, and my understanding from Hank is that it's below what garage size and height should have as a minimum. And so when you park both cars in the garage, it is not possible to really get to the entrance of the house that is inside the garage, because there's almost no space, especially when you carry baby strollers and car seats.
Okay, so once you put the car in the garage, getting to that door is blocked by the car. So my concern with this is also the flat roof, because you don't have a flat roof anywhere on this house. Are you, what made you decide to go with flat roof?
So we have a window of the bedroom above the garage. So to run into the window didn't make sense. And to pitch it the other way, then you basically create a barrier where the snow collects.
Well, obviously you're not going to pitch it toward the house, and I get that.
Right.
Yes, that's exactly right. If you look at the detail, it would have to be a shed roof if that were the case.
Mm-hmm.
I talked to Hank about that, because that was my question as well before we came to the meeting. And in fact, there are numerous sets of windows that run across there, and I can show you the detail.
No, I mean, I can see it on here.
Right.
I wanted him to articulate why he chose a flat roof.
Got it.
How many trees will have to come down for this?
There's one pine tree that sits right where the garage is supposed to go. So I assume that this is the only tree that has to come out.
So, so this is the tree you'll have to take down.
Let me see.
Here. That tree will have to come down.
Oh, this is a small tree.
Okay, well that one will have to come down too, because you're going to need a driveway. I understand, but that tree is right up the edge of the driveway, isn't it?
No, this is
that,
where,
that
this
tree,
is
not this tree.
Yeah,
this
I
tree
understand.
Back here.
I didn't measure it. I was under the understanding that we can keep that tree because we would twice as we buy it.
And what will be the effect on this tree of changing the driveway? Because you're going to have to. Are you going to have a bigger apron? Not planned. No bigger apron. You're just going to come out.
Why don't you make your points clearer so everyone understands what's being exchanged?
So my question is when I look at this picture, I see no dropping thing. I see a tree here, and I'm just curious to know if this tree is coming out. He says that the driveway will not expand the apron, but will just come out, and that he'll miss this tree. But I would think that adding concrete is going to affect that tree in some way. So my question was, are we losing this tree?
And the answer was?
I believe we're not
losing the tree, but I'm not entirely sure.
Yeah, I mean, if you look, I mean, I can't tell from the picture exactly how many feet from the original driveway this tree is, but my guess is that it's going to get hit with driveway.
Mm-hmm.
If, by the look of it, I mean, it looks like it's maybe like 3-4 feet off of the original driveway.
Mm-hmm.
So I was concerned, are we losing something? So that's a concern of mine. And other than that, I just, I understand why you're doing the flat roof. I do feel it, from a design aesthetic, it looks kind of awkward. I know, I see why you're doing it, because you don't want to affect the second floor of the house where the bedrooms are. Well, your shed roof would have to, again, it's not, we're not here to design it. I'm just saying I feel it looks awkward. And that's it.
Kim, do you feel comfortable participating, given when you came in?
Probably not. I mean, I don't know what questions have been answered. I know some of mine were the roof.
That's really the only question.
I mean,
today.
Yeah. Do you have any comments?
So, as I did come in at the end of that, is the three-car garage under our standards, or that's the zoning issue they have to go to?
Well, it would definitely require a zoning board approval. I mean, appeals, variance.
Variance.
So even if approved, there's no guarantee that passes zoning. That was really it. I don't have a concern in how it looks. I did have a question on the roof, but I understand it and see how it fits in the design of the house.
John?
No comment.
My question is, leaving aside the ZBA square footage issue, is there any applicable ordinance or regulation that is in any way violated? And I guess I'll ask that question, but I think I know the answer to that question. Do you know?
The answer is no.
Okay.
And other than materials here, and obviously it's going to require a variance.
Mm-hmm.
We know that because of the size, right? The
mm-hmm.
size of it. In talking to Hank about this, the answer is no to that question. This is more of a matter of detail in terms of material use.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously then size in terms of what the ZBA will allow or not allow.
I'm uncomfortable for the same reason that Martha is, in that I think consistency is very important. And I don't remember what we did on that three-car garage. I just don't remember what we did. But it was a big deal. Now, there wasn't a livability issue there, as has been presented here. On the other hand, this house is not a new house, and the previous owners presumably lived well, but maybe not, in terms of using the garage, being able to get inside the house. And I'm uncomfortable that we don't have, although this is not directly relevant to any of the regulations, a understanding of what's going to happen to the trees, which, you know, we typically inquire into, and whether or not the driveway has been actually designed so that we know what will actually be there. I guess a final question that I have is, we normally don't see flat roofs, if ever, and have you done anything to make sure that there isn't pooling and that it's going to be structurally sound? There are some flat roofs, but not a lot. Just making sure that when it rains, you know, it's going to properly.
So in speaking with the architect, he says the roof is graded in such a way
it will
that
be
the water rolls off.
So it's not quite flat.
So it's not quite flat, but it's not that you visibly see it and therefore interfere with the second level.
Did you retain an architect? You obviously did. Did the architect give you a reason as to why it's a flat roof as opposed to something with an incline?
So if you look at the structure right now, it basically, and you can see it on the drawing as well, it's like slightly cantilevered, and the garage would basically slide under the little overhang.
Uh-huh.
I think it's a 2-foot overhang that currently is existing, and therefore, he said that's the best solution to basically slide it down and to make it look as one piece, just like a covered on the garage side.
Well, I guess at the end of the day, I'm very reluctant to punt it to the ZBA, but this is something that they're going to have to grapple with, and it's not a pro forma issue. And there is nothing else that we could look to for a basis of denying this request. Does anyone have a motion that they want to make, or any? Well, actually, why don't we open it to public discussion?
Before you go in, just out of curiosity, and again, I don't know if I'm jogging with memory for either you or Martha or Jill. When we did the last one where it had the 3-car garage, was it a new build, or was it someone who was looking to expand?
It was
a new
build.
That was
a new
build.
Well, that's, the only one I can remember with a 3-car garage was the Sal Lane, and that was that side, that's the side entrance. But I don't remember someone coming in front of us with a 3-car garage. There was an expansion to a home looking to add a third.
No, we didn't do
car
that.
No, there was not.
It was a new build.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I know the one that's on, doesn't the one on Talbot Lane have a 3-car garage as well? The one that's the like more prairie stylish one? Because that one's built with a 3-car garage.
Well,
no, it's on the side. Correct. Yeah, on the side.
I mean, this is something that would presumably require meaningful discussion by the ZBA, unlike what we typically see, where we assume that it's going to go through. So I guess the question is, do we as a committee or commission feel comfortable passing something on to the ZBA under these circumstances?
Can I?
My 2 cents is, if there isn't a standard, a guideline that you can point to.
Right.
I think that's the ZBA's job.
Right.
That's my 2 cents.
So
I would agree with Sheldon as well.
Yeah.
I don't know that there's anything that I can point to in the anywhere that says that we.
I think I see it that way too, Sheldon. That you know, the materials are good. Everything. I mean, Hank didn't point out anything in the notes other than the square footage, which is clearly under the jurisdiction of the ZBA.
And that's exactly what Hank reiterated to me prior to the needle going into his arm for his knee replacement.
You know, that came across really bad.
No. IV, that's what I meant to
Thank
say.
Thank you.
Is that it certainly meets the criteria for the materials usage, which is predominantly what we're looking at.
Yeah, that's clear. Thank you. Okay. Any other comment among us before we open up public participation?
Do you have any sense of your landscaping? Usually when people come, they have some indication of what they're going to do with their landscaping.
Right now there is no plan on changing the landscaping. We will have lived through 4 seasons first. Part of the reason why we made the decision to buy the house is of the beautiful landscaping. It's a large lot. It's on 28,000 and some square foot. And it's very nice with the trees in the backyard. It's such a quiet setting. So right now there's no plan. We just want to get that addition done, and that's it.
Have you shown this plan to any of your neighbors?
I have shown this plan to my only neighbor, which is Louise Wibbleman. She lives right behind us, and she even sent me a written piece of document saying that she approves the addition. She thinks it looks very nice. It would balance out the house from all sides. She understands that the footprint, in terms of lot coverage, changes only slightly. We're going, I think, from 10.83 to 11.something%. And she is all in favor of this.
Jill?
You were asking about, does it meet all the standards? And I just want to point out that there is a standard BB. Proposed roof line, pitch, and materials are compatible with existing buildings in the same neighborhood. Number 4 says the roof is not flat. Just throwing that out there.
Well, that's more than throwing that out there. Does that suggest that this is not in compliance with this ordinance? I mean, you did say that it's
it's
this standard
slope.
Standard
a standard.
Yeah.
The standard says for gable, gambrel, hip, and similar roofs. So that's a gambrel. Similar roof styles, the direction of the main roof ridge follows the direction of adjacent buildings, most instances it will be parallel to the front street. A reverse gable is not higher than the main gable. If there is only one main roof ridge, the roof is not flat. In addition to above, the following guidelines apply to exterior additions. Type of roof should addition to not exceed the main gable.
But keep in mind, we have approved flat roofs in the past. On this commission. We have?
I don't remember. That's the thing. That's what's bothering me. I don't recall approving a flat roof.
They weren't in front of the house.
Yeah.
They weren't in front of the house.
Right.
We approved additions in the back.
You asked about how it affects this. I'm simply reading the standard.
Because we had a discussion on EPDM or something.
Yes, we did.
Oh, yeah, we did. I remember that material. You're right.
Yes, we did.
Good memory. Let me ask this question. Did you and your architect consider having a sloped roof that, you know, peaks at a elevation, say, at the same level of as maybe the bottom of the window on the second floor?
So we talked about this, and I don't have the measurements with me exactly. The architect said it would not look so consistent, and he suggested to go with a more flat roof because of the effect to slide it under the cantilever. And he said the roof itself is not flat, it has a slight incline for the water to run off.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not really talking about a flat roof. It appears as a flat roof.
It does appear as a flat roof in the elevation.
I do not love a flat roof. I understand why you've done it. I understand you don't want to interfere with the second story of the house as it is existing today. You don't want to affect that side of how it looks from the side.
Mm-hmm.
I understand that. I'm not saying I love a flat roof, but I do understand why it's being done. And I have a feeling that aesthetically, if you try and put some type of a shed roof off of the side of that house, what you're going to end up doing is you're going to end up interfering with this line, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And it's going to look not appealing.
Yeah.
Well,
it'll look more awkward.
It'll look more, it may look
awkward.
More awkward than the flat roof does.
Then this is not in dimension with or in perspective, because just penciling across and knowing that these windows line up with the windows on the side, there is room for a shed roof at the same angle.
I understand that, but what I'm saying is that from an aesthetic point of view, if you do that, you are affecting how the entire side of this house looks,
mm-hmm.
and you will be changing the look and the design of the original house.
Right.
So
I guess you have to decide which design is better or worse.
I guess what I'm saying is I think that it could end up looking a lot more awkward than this flat-roofed garage would look. I don't love the way the flat roof garage looks, but I have a feeling that if you try and do a shed roof off of that, you're going to destroy the style of the other side of this house.
Okay.
But that's my opinion.
Okay. Anything else from any of us before we open up to public participation? David?
Just a point of information. There's a ultra-modern house.
You want to say who you are and address?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Address.
I apologize. David Sloan, 8050 Lincoln, Huntington Woods. Dave,
can
you
go up to the microphone, please?
Okay, yes, sir. David Sloan, 8050 Lincoln, Huntington Woods. Just for your information, there's that ultra-modern house built in 1988. It's on York Street, just north of Concord. It's on the east side, and that does have a flat roof. Now, of course, different planning commissions are controlled by others, but I just thought I'd...
Thank you for that. Okay. Any other public comment? Does anyone want to make a motion?
I move to approve, subject to ZBA approval.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
Nay.
6-2. I do think you have, congratulations on getting through us.
Thank you.
I think you're gonna have your work put out at the ZBA because it is an awkward fit.
Mm-hmm.
And this was a hard one, at least for me personally.
Mm-hmm. Good. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.
That's why I say it all goes to the ZBA.
Thank you.
I did it. Okay. That was it.
Did you see my point?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely.
Oh, I'm sure they did.
Okay, the next item on the agenda is the matter of discussion of zoning ordinance revision. And Ben, you weren't at the last meeting. What specifically are you addressing tonight?
Thank you. Good evening. My understanding is tonight we're really trying to hopefully finalize the issue of what the formula is going to be for lot bonus based on increase over the minimum lot area, and secondly is to what is the maximum cap for each district in terms of house size. I have provided you with a revised memo. Again, this was based on the discussion the Planning Commission had at the previous meeting. It's a column on the right-hand side, number 4, indicates the maximum house size with all bonuses applied. Crossed-out number is what was shown to the Planning Commission at the last meeting. The number to the right is that's based, my understanding, based on the consensus of the commission.
If I might say, when we discussed this last time, according to, there was some typos in this that seems to still be there.
I wasn't aware of what those were. If you want to tell me what they were.
Maybe I wrote it down wrong, but on the R1D column, what I remember seeing was that this 2,500 plus 1 square foot was actually supposed to be 2,600 was what it got corrected to. And maybe my notes are incorrect. I'm looking at my notes, but.
Because we were starting at the number plus the 600 feet, right, that you were already getting for the character bonus?
That's right.
So that started at 2,000, then it was plus 600, is that what it came?
I believe that that's the correction I have. It, and
yeah.
That's one of the things that I have a hard time with in what was done here
Let me take a step back here. What kind of came to my attention a couple weeks ago as I was reviewing this and I wasn't at the last meeting is how this formula has been applied. Basically, states that you're only eligible for the lot bonus. So that we have two different kinds of bonuses. I want to be very clear on that. That we have the character bonus, which is the 600 maximum based on, you know, basically a menu of options to consider. On top of that, we have the lot area bonus, which is you get extra square footage if your lot is over the minimum lot size. So we're talking about two different bonuses. As the formula was written, the lot bonus is only applicable if you get the 600 square feet character bonus. I think that's confusing. My understanding is what the commission wanted was there's two bonuses. You can still get the lot bonus even without getting the character bonus. If I'm incorrect with that, please let me know.
No, you're correct.
Okay,
correct.
So what I've done, and I don't want to confuse the matters more, is I've actually redone a table here. And the table goes through every single district, goes through what the minimum house size is, what the maximum house size is without any bonuses, and then goes through each bonus what the maximum could be for each district. So I'm going to pass that out. I don't want to confuse the matter anymore, but this.
Thank you.
So I'll walk us all through this, and hopefully this will make a little So, I'm just going to use, I'm just going to start with R1A. The R1A, your minimum lot size is 30,000 square feet. Your maximum floor area ratio without any bonuses is 3,600 square feet. Again, this is what's be, what this is what's currently in the draft proposal. That's 3,600 square feet is 600 less than what you're currently allowed under the existing ordinance. You can go up to 4,800 square feet. With the character bonus, you can get an additional 600 square feet. The lot bonus is in addition to that, and that's 1 square foot for every 14 square feet above the 30,000. That gets you up to a total of 750 additional square feet. That's under the assumption that we're separating the two bonuses, that you can still get the lot area bonus without getting the character bonus. So the most important column is the one here on the right. It's the maximum floor area per dwelling unit. 3,600 without any bonus, 4,200 with a square, with a character bonus, 4,350 with just the lot bonus, the maximum. And if you combine the two, up to 4,950 with the character bonus and a lot bonus combined. That 4,950 was a number pulled out, I believe, by Commissioner Sullivan based on his formula. So that was the cap number, and I kind of worked backwards to get what the 750 of the lot bonus would be. So I applied that for every single district in the city, all five districts.
Well, and this is, we did vote on this. And it was a 6-2 vote to basically approve this scheme. And my understanding was that the issue was done, and that we had acted. However, in the discussions afterward, there were a couple discussions, and the question is whether every single member of the commission was comfortable with what had happened and whether all issues had been fully vetted. I will say that I had a conversation, do you mind my saying,
nope.
Jill? With Jill, and she expressed her concern about the result, notwithstanding the fact that it was a compromise and there was a consensus with just two commission members voting against it. And this is very helpful and it reflects the consensus, I believe. And when I got to brass tacks with Jill, and I'm not going to advocate for Jill, I'll let obviously Jill speak for herself. At the end of the day, the issue as described to me was a discomfort with R1D and R1E and what the permissible house size, maximum house size would be under the compromise, which in this regard was not a compromise, because the negotiating didn't take into the smaller lots in the way that it did on the bigger lots, and that the maximum house size on the smaller lots was, in I think Jill's opinion, too big. Once you add bonus, basically, is it appropriate on R1Ds to have 2,600 maximum size houses, square feet, if you have a, if you include everything from the character bonus, and whether for R1E, 2,300 square feet was too big? Did houses of that size constitute, under the circumstances, with the small lot sizes, Bigfoot houses that would kind of look like houses on steroids and kind of blot out or encroach upon the houses next door, which presumably are smaller? And with that issue being framed, and I think I've framed it accurately, I want to turn it over to Jill.
So my one of the things that bothers me about this is that I don't believe it was necessarily a compromise. All it really did was address the oversized lots. And we talked about the lot size bonus. That is the only thing that got addressed. We did not at all address whether or not the sizes of houses that could be put on these much smaller lots is what it should be. For example, I even just have to put out there that in R1D, this compromise added 100 square feet to the maximum house size from where we used to be. It actually even made it bigger. So I'm concerned about that. So one of the things that I did in my discussion with Andy is I pointed out to him different houses in the neighborhood where bungalows have come down and bigger houses have been put up. And I think that that's some of the data that we asked you to pull, which is right here. And I think it's sometimes it's very difficult for people to imagine a number and think, okay, the lot size is X, the house size is Y. It's hard to picture what that looks like on the lot. And so what I asked Andy to do was to go around and just kind of look at some of these houses and get an assessment of, from his perspective, because everyone has their own opinion, of how much yard space is left. How much is that house overshadowing the houses next to it? And I'm very concerned about a couple of things, and I've brought this up before. I'm concerned about we have an aging population, and that aging population is going to want to have a certain number of houses available to it that has a bedroom on the first floor. Every one of those bungalows that comes down goes up as a two-story house, rebuilt as a two-story house, and you're losing houses that have bedrooms on the first floor.
And full bathrooms
on the first floor. You're losing that. So you have less houses for people to downsize into as they get older, where they can handle, you know, the fact that there are any stairs and you can get in. I think that every time a bungalow comes down and one of these bigger houses go up, we're raising the price point of the entry of a young couple trying to buy a starter house. We're losing those starter houses. And we're making it, every time we start losing them, those builders are going to come in and they're going to put the maximum amount of square footage on that lot that they can to maximize the amount of money that they make. But it puts that price point for that new buyer up around $300,000 to $400,000, sometimes $500,000. And so you're losing houses that people can buy into to live in this neighborhood as a young couple. And I don't see that as a good thing. You're losing your yard space. So you're putting up this great big house and you're losing the backyard. There's no room for that playscape. People start living inside their houses instead of outside their houses. We lose that neighborhood feel. I understand that people want to have space to raise their families. I get that. I do. But I think that there has to be a middle ground where we can preserve some of these smaller houses and keep that backyard space and keep that ability for our elderly people to move into, to downsize into a smaller house, or for that young couple to come in and buy the house before they have their first baby, or maybe have their first one or first or two in that house before they move on to a bigger house. So the bungalows are just going to get picked off one after another, and as those other bigger houses get built around them, the bungalows that are left sandwiched between these bigger houses become less valuable and they become more fodder for these builders to come in and take them down. And then when we run out of bungalows, it's going to be those small colonials. And it's just, and pretty soon, we lose the look and the feel of Huntington Woods, and we lose one of the things that people love about this place. We lose the varied architecture, and we lose the ability to have younger families and medium-sized families and people growing older and stay in your same neighborhood when you get old. The ranches are getting picked off. The bungalows are picked off. We are losing what makes Huntington Woods the community that it is, and we will become Birmingham.
Yeah.
And that is what I would like to prevent. So when I look at these things, and I see it where you can put a 2,600 square foot house on a lot that is 50 by 120, I see those things that I love about Huntington Woods slipping away. And I don't want to look at people and say, I'm sorry, you can't have your giant house because I said you can't. No, it's, we should limit what the houses can be and how and how much, even with character bonuses, that maybe we lower the starting point of that. The character bonuses are great, but maybe our starting point isn't 2,000 square feet. Maybe the starting point is 1,800 square feet. Maybe we bring that down such that you can add on to your house, but you can't take away all the character and all the things that make Huntington Woods different from Birmingham. That is my point.
Thank you, Jill. Yes.
So, a few things in my mind.
One, I think one of the major considerations we have to have here is the fact that there is no one-size-fits-all that's going to work for what we're trying to propose here. There's no perfect solution for any of us. I think we can all pretty much agree on that. Based on the varied lot sizes that we have in all of the different districts, there is no perfect solution here. The city of Huntington Woods, in my mind, is whether you're going after a current bungalow or you're going to buy one of the brand new houses that someone tore a bungalow down and rebuilt, is already at a crazy price point. I mean, I have friends who have a bungalow that's a pretty standard bungalow that has a detached one-car garage on Borgman. They have an 1,100 square foot bungalow, and they're probably going to get $340,000 for that house, $350,000. They've done nothing to it because that's what houses are going for in this neighborhood right now. We're not a starter home community for someone coming out of college looking for a bungalow, even if they're married and they both have jobs. It's just this, that's not, you can't come into Huntington Woods these days and do that. I mean, unless you have some really, really, really good jobs. I mean, you're living in Berkeley for a few years and then you're moving to Huntington Woods, or you're living in Oak Park for a few years or somewhere else. I don't think that this is a starter home community. It just isn't. Now, whether or not once you get here, you want to stay here and you want to get into a home that you can then age into that's age appropriate, that's a little bit of a different story. But I don't feel that if we take what you're saying, even in, first off, when I'm looking at R1D and R1E in the current ordinance has maximums for both of those districts. If you were to get your lot bonus and everything else, the maximum not to exceed is 3,500 square feet for both R1D and R1E. And what we're proposing here is 2,950 in R1D and 2,700 in R1E, which is a fairly significant decrease to what the max is. Now, whether you could actually get to those maxes because of the lot sizes would never get there or not, but I mean, that's what we were trying to do, was trying to lessen those. Now, if you were to take what's being proposed right now in R1D at 2950, and let's say we started at 1,800 square feet, and the max you could get is 2750, that's still a big house next to a small house. If I have an 1,100 square foot bungalow, and we are going to allow people to tear down a house and build a new house, they're not going to build an 1,100 square foot bungalow. They just won't. Now, whether or not that's 3,000 feet or 2,700 feet or whatever it is, I don't think 100 or 200 feet here or there are going to get you what you're looking for in the next home that's being built on that lot.
What I'm saying is I think that we have looked at the top end, and we've looked at that 2,950 and that 2,700, and what I'm saying is that I think our starting point should be lower.
Right, but if you take your starting point down by 200 square feet, wouldn't that only take the maximum down by 200 square feet?
Well, the thing is you're looking at the maximum on those, on the lot bonus.
I'm looking at the maximum on both bonus. If you were to get everything, character and lot.
Right.
Because don't
not,
you have
not,
to look at the maximum?
But maybe you should be looking at the maximum with just the character bonus. Because not all the lots are oversized. So the majority of the lots are not oversized. So I'm looking at the 2,600 square foot house on the R1D that I think.
So then aren't you shunning the person who is a 1,100 square foot bungalow next to an oversized lot where someone could be 2,950?
Slides everything down. It slides everything back down. So it would stay proportional, but it'd be a little bit lower. And I get your point about, price points in here might be $300,000 for the bungalow or whatever, but does that mean it's okay to make the price point, to take all the bungalows down and make the price point for entry $500,000 or $600,000? Is that okay?
But are you going
to
take...
Does that make it better?
But are you going to take... So, I mean,
this is, to me, it's a fatalistic discussion if you go to the point where you say that all of the bungalows are being taken down. You know, I mean, that's like my mom getting in an argument with me and saying, you know, I love
you. I'm saying that over time, they're getting picked off.
Yeah.
And they're getting picked off at a rate of X number a year. And that's just going to keep going. And I'm not saying in 5 years they're all going to be gone, or in 10 years they're all going to be gone. But if you come, but if you have children that want to be in Huntington Woods 40 years from now, it's going to look incredibly different than it does now. And it's going to look a heck of a lot more like Birmingham. And again, you're entitled to your opinion, and I'm entitled to my opinion.
Agreed.
And we obviously have some serious differences between what we think is okay and what we think is not okay.
But like Andy said at the last meeting, at the end of the day, we as a body need to come up with either we're going to stick with what we've got, or we're coming up with something different that's going to work such that we can then... I mean, this thing has a long way to go before it gets anywhere through. It's got to go through the community. It's got to go through the city commission. So the question becomes, what are we putting forth?
I understand, but if you're going to call this a compromise, this is not a compromise.
On the low end.
This is a compromise on the high end. Yeah. And I'm asking, since you got what you wanted on the high end, that you give us back a little bit, those of us who would like to keep things a little bit smaller, that you give us a little bit of a compromise in the low end. That's what I'm asking for. And slide it back down a little bit. That's
are you talking about before. Sliding it back down on
to
all,
just D&E?
To just D&E?
Those are my main concern. Those are truly my main concern. Excuse me?
Nothing.
D&E are my main concern, because I think that those are the ones that are mostly affected, because R1C already has bigger houses on it. Most of those houses are already bigger. They're not. Those are not the ones that are getting picked off.
Where do we stand on this right now?
We have a vote.
Because we've got, what was the 6-2 vote?
That was to approve exactly what we're arguing over right now.
So that has
been... It'll require a new motion to change what we voted on last time, essentially.
Possibly decreasing the starting
point
for D
and
E.
That's the issue. And let me just give you some perspective. First of all, I really want to thank Jill for her energy and her diligence, because there's nothing wrong and everything right with making a fully informed decision and making sure that it's fully informed. And when she gave me those houses, it allowed me to go to each house one by one by one, take a picture of each house, get a feel for how the house fits into the neighborhood, and, you know, really come to terms with the size and scale issue in a way that I personally can't, given the fact that I need to see something in order to feel it. And the exercise was invaluable. And as Jill said, it's a subjective, inherently subjective opinion. I did get the feeling in looking at everything that it's a close call. That some of the houses made me feel uncomfortable, like there's too much going on and too much house for the space. I do notice, and thank you very much to Amy for summarizing the houses pointed out by Jill, as to it will allow us to contextualize what we're looking at. And some of the houses I did look at, they couldn't build today based on the compromise or whatever language we're using for those, you know, smaller lot, high ends. But the bottom line is that they were, I won't call them tight fits. I don't think that they blotted out the sun, but they certainly dramatically change the character of that neighborhood in that area. It didn't offend my sensibility, because I think we live in a world where people want higher house size. But, you know, that exercise certainly allowed me to contextualize what Jill is talking about, more so than when we voted the last time. And I guess my question is, since we would have to approve another pass another motion, is whether you would be, for the sake of compromise, be willing to shave off some of on the lots that, you know, are the smallest ones, not taking into account larger lots in these areas, you know, some square footage off of the maximum house size, i.e. lowering the initial starting point, because I don't think anyone wants to screw around with the bonus features.
Can I just ask one question real quick? So if I'm...
And maybe Ben can weigh in on this. Right now, the minimum that you start with in D and E is 2,500 square feet for D and 2,300 square feet for E. And then the only bonuses you get are based on...
26.
No.
I'm saying in the current. I'm saying in our current ordinance.
Yes.
Okay.
In our current ordinance, you start at 2,500 square feet,
mm-hmm.
and you in D, you get 1 square foot for every 6 foot
yeah.
over 6,000, not to exceed 3,500. In E, it's 2,300 with 1 square foot for every 6 feet over 5,000 square feet, not to exceed 3,500 as well. We've backed down from the starting point at 2,500 in R1D to 2,000. And we've backed down from the starting point of 2,300 to 1,700 in R1E.
Yeah, but then you have the 600 square feet per character.
But you're going to get your 600 square feet.
Right.
I mean, they're going to do those things.
Okay,
any smart builder is going to do
that. Any smart builder is going to do that.
Yeah,
so
no,
your starting point is 26.
Your starting point is basically higher.
Yeah, your starting
point
is...
Your starting point's already higher than where you would have...
Yeah.
Okay.
You're starting... In 1D, you're starting at 2,600. Let's be realistic.
100 square feet higher.
Let's be realistic. Any builder worth their salt is going to put in those bonuses and get that square footage.
Well, yeah.
So you're really starting at 26 and you're starting at 23. So in reality, in R1D, you're 100 square feet higher than you were currently.
Is it 26 or 25?
It's 26.
So
and it's 23. It hasn't changed.
Okay, so we all sat in this room last time and said 26 was the original number. That is incorrect, right? That should be fixed, but that's what was said. We said 25 was a typo and 26 is the number.
Well, that's what is now on here. Yeah, that's...
Okay, so here's my struggle, right? Ages ago, we got in this room, right, and started talking about this issue, right? So 2,600 square boxes, right? In the sense of those being dominating the smaller homes beside them. And we argued for a long time about lots and lots and lots of options to do that, to fix that. One of them was just to reduce the square footage. And everybody compromised, ended up going with a character bonus, right? And the intent of the character bonus is to adjust the design of the house in such a way that when it is 2,600 square feet, it does not look as massive as the houses beside it.
I agree.
That was the idea. Now, I'm not necessarily opposed to reducing the 2,600 or 2,500 or whatever the max number is, but I'm concerned that we've built up a house of cards of compromises here. And if we shift that number, I want to talk about the character bonus too, because I'm not sure that we want to do, we're going to undo this compromise, right? The intent of the character bonus was to address the issue of compatibility with houses beside you. And if that is not addressing the issue of compatibility, then maybe it's not the right thing to have in there.
I don't look at that as the right issue, respectfully.
Okay, what is right?
I think we're all agreed that the character bonuses serve their intended purposes, and I don't know that anyone has spoken until now about altering the character bonuses, which serve a very important effect, including the step-in. But I think the issue is, would it offend anyone's sensibilities if we were to shave off of, in R1D and R1E, 100 square feet, well, 100 or 200, depending on what the compromise might be, on the starting point, so that at the end of the day, there's less likely to be a house that is visually oppressive or otherwise oversized for the lot. Now, I looked at the Tripp's house on Kingston, and if you take a look at the Tripp's house on Kingston, you know, they built under what would be allowed, but it's still a somewhat large house, given what it was before. It's 2439. It's 10745 Kingston. You guys don't have this?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought it was distributed to everyone. Does everyone else down there have it?
Yeah.
I don't know how. Oh, it stopped at me. Okay. And I apologize. And that shows how you can significantly.
This is the last house.
This is the last house. Expand a house, have tons of living room, because I know the inside of the Tripp house very well. There are close friends.
Yeah.
And still have a house that is very, very consistent with the neighborhood. And I look at that as possibly a model for what our goal might be. You know, allow living space, allow for growth, but at the same time, not have a house that it looks either like it's taken a small or large dose of steroids. And the question in my mind is limited to R1D, R1E, shaving some amount of square footage off of the starting point, so we're more likely to result in a Tripp house than some of the other houses that I did look at that, you know, to say that I would say it's fair to say push the envelope and leave you a little bit uncomfortable, particularly say some of the houses on Hart, which, you know, if you go on Hart near Meadowcrest, there are three successive houses in a row, and I think you're going to visualize, and one directly across the street, but the three in the row on Hart really do bring home the potential to change the character of the neighborhood in a way that I think Jill and others find troubling. And so, and there was some Facebook chatter today that someone sent around about just that issue, and all we're doing right now is deciding whether, and I'm going to use the word again, shaving that minimum size on the smaller lot, I mean the starting point size on those smaller lots, whether that offends this commission. It doesn't offend me.
And I don't know that it's necessarily that I can say that it offends me.
I think that where I have difficulty, and maybe, I mean, to some degree kind of piggybacking off of maybe where I think Aaron was going with this, is that if I look at where we started with in what we have today for R1D and R1E, where we started with today with R1D is a 2,500 square foot house that you can build.
Mm-hmm.
And if I, and what's that?
And now you can build a 26.
No, now you can build a 2,000 square foot house.
No,
well, but wait a second, like, hear me out, Jill. Yeah, before you shake your head and say, no, what you can build now is a 2,000 square foot box. I can build a 2,000 square foot brick box just like we built today, like we approved several times on this commission, unfortunately, before we had our brick statue, et cetera. I can build a 2,000 square foot box next to a 1,000 square foot bungalow that has zero character.
Okay.
And we can't disapprove it because it's brick, I have all my windows, et cetera, right? So I'm doubling the size of the home that's next to me.
So let's make it an 1,800 square foot.
But my
box.
Point is, my point piggybacking off of what Aaron was
box.
Saying
one
was
one
that,
time,
my point piggybacking, I think, off of what Aaron was saying was that we went through ad nauseum what we felt needed to take place to get us to the point where that house could be that 2,600 square foot home. And that was based on trying to provide these character bonuses that allowed us to get away from the massing issues that we were seeing, the step-ins, the roof heights, etc. I tend to disagree to some degree that every single house that comes in front of us is going to have 100% of the character bonus, regardless of how good your architect is. I think that people are still going to want 28-foot roofs, roof heights, because they're going to want to be at a place where they can build and have 9-10-foot ceilings in their first floors and their second floors. And I think it's going to be a little bit more challenging in some of these homes to get to 26 feet, such that they're going to get 100% of the character bonus to come into us for every single time with a 2,600 square foot home. I have trouble taking it down further from where it is, from where we are right now. I don't see it getting us anywhere.
Well, I live in that area.
And I did.
And my house is a 1,500 square foot house, and I can't imagine putting much more on my lot without having nothing left but a bunch of mud in the backyard behind the garage. And my neighbors have all told me, stay on this commission and speak for us, because we don't want these Bigfoot houses in our neighborhood. My neighbors on Elgin have told me that. My neighbors on Nadine have told me that, and on Hart have told me that. So maybe you think it's okay to have a 3,000 square foot, which is what you could max out to at this point on this.
If your lot's bigger.
If your lot's bigger.
If your lot's bigger.
Right.
But we only have one lot that's bigger, and he's got a little tiny house, and he's happy.
But where
us.
Are
some
these? Where
us.
Are these people?
Some of. Well,
can we expand the dialogue
yeah.
to
yeah.
this end of the table?
Yeah,
please.
Sheldon.
Okay. The description of the slippery slope that results in Birmingham, I think, is overwrought. Okay. Because I've seen Birmingham and I've seen Bigfoots, and what we're talking about is nothing like that. We've still got our side lots. Birmingham's Bigfoots go right to the edges of the lots and that sort of thing. We still have the protections in our ordinances that prevent that. Second, I don't think that anybody can definitively tell me, and I really don't expect it, that one or 200 square feet, one way or the other, is going to be the tipping point that makes a difference. And I think that we have attempted as best we can in terms of a legislative function, or at least a suggestion of legislative function. I think we've done what we can do here to ameliorate some of those massing questions, just as pointed out by Aaron and Eric, that say you can put those up because we are trying to reduce the impact of that particular house on the neighborhood. I also am concerned that by trying to preserve the smaller houses that are there, you're effectively killing them anyway, because you're not going to, people are going to be, and I don't have any data to back this up, it's just gut, people are going to be reluctant to buy them because they can't do what they want with them. They can't adapt to an expanding family. If you're talking about a bungalow, you're talking about upstairs and downstairs anyway, which is may or may not be appropriate to aging in place kind of stuff. So my story is that I think that some of the concerns of pointing to doom and gloom are not justified, and I don't think that you can tell me that identifying 100 square feet or 200 square feet is going to be the tipping point that's going to ruin the neighborhood. I really don't, because I just think those can be, when you're talking a house that's 40 or 50 feet deep on a lot by maybe 30 foot wide, I mean, you're talking about a foot in each direction, kind of. It just, and you still got to meet the side lot variances. So I'm concerned that that's there, and as far as whether or not we're going to end up with entry-level houses at the $500,000 level, well, it depends on whose entry you're talking about. You know, if somebody wants to write me a check right now for $350,000 for my house, it's good. Yeah. You know, I'm good.
Don't
good
go.
With that, okay, and then you won't have me on the commission, and I won't be and I won't be doing any of that. That's okay. You know, I'll find a place where I can rest my head with what's left. But I just think that some of the, I mean, and I appreciate the work that went into it, but the houses we've got are the houses we've got. And whether or not we would approve those in the current circumstances, for instance, this list, I don't know how many of those houses have the characteristics that we're talking about that would justify bonuses.
That's a good question. A lot of
whether
them don't.
Blocks.
A lot of them don't, in all fairness.
All right. So, I mean, I don't want to do it over, and I don't expect anybody to do it over or anything. All I'm doing is I'm trying to bring this down to some realities and recognize the fact that I'm not sure that we improve anything by tweaking a number one way or the other. I'm not foundationally opposed to it. I'm just not thinking that it makes anything better than what we've got, and I'm not convinced by the slippery slope arguments particularly. So that's where I'm
Here's my question to the commission.
thank you for those comments, Sheldon. We've got two people here in Jill and Martha who have very strong opinions about the starting point, particularly for R1D and R1E. My question is there any willingness, again, in the spirit of compromise so that everyone can say that we vetted this and that this specific issue wasn't talked about last time is now being talked about, so that, you know, the decision we arrive at has both decision-making integrity and, to the extent possible, as much consensus as possible. And therefore, my question is there an appetite or willingness to entertain shaving off, and I'll just throw a number out there, 100 square feet off of the starting point on the homes on the R1D and R1E lots? Just an informal poll. What are people thinking about that 100 square foot concession in the spirit of compromise on those two districts? Yes, no?
In my view, I don't think the arguments haven't carried the day for me.
So you would say no?
I think it's the obligation of those who want to change it to convince that what we have is not appropriate, and they haven't, from my standpoint.
Okay.
They haven't.
Have you gone out and looked at any of these houses and looked at the lots?
I didn't have this list.
Yeah.
I know, but as you drive around the neighborhood, you and we approve houses. Have you gone out and looked at the finished products?
Those houses are there.
I get it. Have you looked at the finished products?
Have I looked at the finished products? I drive down the streets like everybody else.
I get it, but I mean, have you
stopped? Okay, there's one house that stands out to me. That's the one in the next block on Nadine, the Castle House.
Mm-hmm.
You know, which is everybody's like, you know, it's like the horrid house. You know, and yeah, it's there. Okay, you know, it's well landscaped and it's and all the rest of that. So would we approve it now? Would I like it now? No, I wouldn't like it now because it's just too damn big. But hopefully, these kinds of features would ameliorate that. No, I haven't gone down this list and looked at all these.
And just so the record's clear, and I've said it before, I did look at each one of these houses one by one, and the shaving off of 100 square feet, while I don't think it's a necessity, I'm agreeing with you, Sheldon, that, you know, the world's not going to come to an end if we stick to what we agreed to before. The shaving, in my opinion, of 100 square feet would personally give me comfort that we're less likely to be approving houses that are oversized, given the lot size and the presumably smaller size houses of the neighbors. But again, we're talking about finding something in the gray area where everyone could be happy, recognizing that it would be a compromise. So the only thing we can do right now, I think, unless there's further discussion or public participation, is ask for a motion and then allow it to proceed to a vote. Because we have voted last time, and that was something that can only be undone with another vote.
Just want to make one comment.
When I look at the R1D, maybe I didn't understand what was said last time. My intention was that I thought we were all voting for the max size with the character bonus on a standard lot would stay the same. And I thought the statement was made that number should be 2,600, and there was a typo and somewhere it got in 2,500. According to the zoning, according to what's sitting right here, it should be 2,500. I'm perfectly happy putting that back because that was the intention.
But you're not willing to go down to 24?
You're not willing
to come down?
In my personal feeling, the only issue that's been expressed has been the massing issue. And that we put in a 600 square foot character bonus to address that massing issue, and I think we ought to give that the opportunity to see if it resolves or not. If there's another issue, it hasn't been articulated to me in a way I can understand it.
All right, so I'll
what we do about
this way.
It.
I would like to have the starting point go down a minimum 100 square feet.
For which district?
R1D and R1E. I would like to come down. You got your compromise at the high end. I want a little bit of compromise in the low end.
And I want 200 because you got your compromise on the high end. And I'm the one who lives at the low end, and I'd like it to stay the way it is as best we can.
You got what you wanted.
I would like to make one comment about this. I made a proposal that I thought would reflect the desire of reducing the maximum square footage of houses on large lots. I brought that to the commission and then agreed to a compromise with the commission to further reduce that number. Okay.
On those outliers.
I didn't get my compromise.
You did.
Hold on a second, guys. Don't start. No need for this. We can all go back to the tape. It's on YouTube now. We can see what was said and not said. So does anyone want to make a motion?
And I would just like to make a comment for the record so that it's out there. I feel really good about what we've done with the character bonus issue to reduce the massing. And I like the way we worked through the numbers at the higher end and the proposal that Aaron brought forth. I don't consider it Aaron's, like, we're appeasing Aaron. I think we worked through that as a group.
Yeah.
And came to a group decision on that. So I'm not taking sides either way. Along with that, though, and in the spirit of compromise, I'm very comfortable with looking at the two districts in question, R1D and R1E, and reducing those starting sizes so that we can all feel good about the proposal that we put forth.
Do you want to make a motion?
I will make a motion. So I will make a motion that we approve. I think it's this one we're looking at
now. Which is very good, thank you. Ben?
With the exchange to, if I have it here correctly, I think it's the fourth column over, the maximum floor area ratio without bonus.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll say that will start at 1,900 square feet instead of 2,000. For R1D and R1E would start at 1,600. Instead of 1,700, and then that will carry through and make some changes over in that last column.
Okay, is there a second for that?
Second. Moment?
You do?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any discussion? Is the public, should we be allowing public participation? David, you want to comment? Okay, so.
Ben has a question.
Ben?
I don't know if, Mr. Chairman, I don't know if this is the appropriate time to mention this.
I hope not. I don't think it is. I think it's the wrong time.
I have to do my job, I mentioned this. Okay. So when I was doing this chart, to get the maximum lot bonus, I subtracted based off the final formula that was presented. I will note that the order, how this should be, obviously, is the larger the lot, the larger the lot bonus. If you look in the column under lot bonus maximum, there's some discrepancy there. For example, you go from 750 to 812 to 625 from R1.
Mm-hmm. We all understand that.
Is that what the commission wants?
We all understand that. That's what we've been working with and the assumptions for the last couple of months, I assume.
What's your question here?
My question is, it's not consistent. For example, R1D, you only get 350 on a larger lot than you would get in R1D, R1E, which is 400. Those obviously in theory, should be flipped. So I'm laying it out there because I'm not sure it was necessarily aware to everybody that's kind of the how this is laid out based on the formula.
That's a function of the lot size, though, isn't it? Mm-hmm. The formula we're using is the same.
Right.
It's mm-hmm. just that the lot size starting point is a different lot size.
Mm-hmm.
That's my understanding.
So the maximum is still the same?
So the maximum is going to be the same, but the bonuses
for
the lot bonuses aren't really reflected in terms of the lot size per se because
they're just
numbers. But they're not in the logical order. If you fall down the larger lot, you should get the larger bonus. But I want to make sure everyone understands that.
Yes, because there was another proposal and we split the difference between that proposal and wasn't a consistent calculation.
Okay, good. I want to make sure
it was consistent with something.
It wasn't based on
the maximum number is consistent. It's just the sausage to get to that maximum number is a little bit wonky here. And I just want to make sure we're all.
It can't be explained.
And that's a very technical. That's a very technical planning term. So.
Yeah.
I think
it's a valid question.
It is a valid question.
Last time.
Right, and this accurately reflects, I believe, what we discussed last time.
Okay.
So there is a motion. It has been seconded. Any discussion on the motion? The motion is on R1D and R1E to reduce column 4, the maximum floor area ratio bonuses without bonuses, by 100 square feet as a starting point. And everything else will follow from there according to the formula. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 1, 2, 3. Okay. All those opposed? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Motion does not carry. And we are where we started at the beginning of the day. I still think the discussion was very good. The record is clear what we're doing and where the commission is. That motion does not pass. Okay. Okay, moving on. We have the election of officers. And did you guys have any discussions about how this was to proceed, or should we just take motions?
I think it's just that.
Okay. First up is chairman. This is for the next term. Does anyone want to make a motion regarding that? Eric?
I would move to re-elect Andy Dockroff as chairman of Planning Commission.
Is there a second,
second
for that?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Okay, thank you. For vice chairman, Martha, do you want to serve again?
No.
Okay. Would anyone like to serve as vice chairperson? Please. Sheldon, would you like to serve as vice chairperson?
Yeah, then I wouldn't have a problem with that. I would give up the other candidate.
Jill, do you want to do it? I mean, whatever. I mean, I don't. Sheldon's ZBA.
Fine, I'll do it.
Sheldon?
I'm
mean,
not doing
do,
ZBA.
Well, Sheldon, I shouldn't have, maybe I should have spoke too soon. Are you okay staying on ZBA? Are you okay staying on ZBA?
You're in trouble.
If somebody wants it,
we're good. Okay, let's try and keep it simple. Alex, anyone want to move for Jill?
I'll make a motion.
Okay.
That Jill is vice chairman of the list.
Okay.
I second.
Okay. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
No.
Now ZBA. I think Sheldon would be willing to serve again as the ZBA voting member liaison. Would anyone like to make that motion?
Motion to appoint Sheldon as ZBA voting
member. Okay. Second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Okay, that's unanimous as well. So we've elected our officers for the next year. Question, who on the commission is not going to be on the commission next year? I mean, do we know that for sure? I mean, is that, have you been told that? Because you haven't been serving that long.
This is my third year. This is my last year.
Okay, so, I mean, I'm just wondering, is it possible to have your term renewed?
Yeah, no, I could renew. You just can't.
Oh, okay, got it. Okay, is anyone else having?
This is my third year, and I honestly don't know what my status is, because Hank said something to the effect that nobody had applied, and he asked me if I could stay on.
Well, I personally think that your voice is critically important, and I hope that you do stay on. Because you define a standard that we all have to consider every single time we vote.
I'm fine with staying on. I just don't know if anybody had applied and if they had someone else to consider.
So at this point,
since I didn't apply.
I was trying to find out the same thing from Hank just before he went in for his surgery, but I never got any response from him.
Chairman, if I may, we are now currently, as we speak, literally today, working on that listing. As well as numerous other boards, which will come to fore here in the either in December or January commission.
Okay. But just so I'm clear, the only person who we know is leaving right now is you, Eric?
Correct.
Okay, well, you've been an incredible voice, incredibly disciplined, incredibly attentive, thoughtful. Thank you very much for your service.
Thank you.
Appreciated by everyone.
Appreciate it.
And with that, we did amend the agenda for other business,
yeah,
but that was done already. Is there any other business that anyone would like to talk about?
That there was a draft report sent around for the annual report to the city commission.
I didn't see it.
I didn't notice it.
Where was that?
It was in the packet.
Yeah, I didn't see it.
Where?
Where? Has anybody looked at our to-do list, high priority, low priority, medium priority, any of those, to decide what we've, or to make an evaluation of what we've accomplished or failed to accomplish?
That has not been, but that is something that I will do with Hank, certainly before year end.
Okay. Is there expected to be a meeting next month?
I believe typically we don't have meetings in December.
No.
Well, I just was curious.
Yeah.
Because of ordinances, we might.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean you can't have
meetings. At this point, there won't be, but if there's a need, we will reach out and have the meeting.
Do we know who the city commission representative is next year?
I don't.
No.
Not at this point, we can.
Okay. Any public participation? I'll have a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Okay, we're adjourned. See you next year, except for you, Eric.
Okay.